Good evening, everyone. We are delighted to have you all here this evening. My name is Premjish Achari, and I'm heading the program and editorial for the exhibition Lokame Tharavadu, The World is One Family, curated by Bose Krishnamachari and organized by Kochi Biennale Foundation. I'm an art curator and art critic, also teaching art history and art theory at the Shivnada University. I welcome all of you to the second round of our online conference, Interrogating the Art Pedagogy, a series curated as part of the academic programs for the exhibition. The series aims to assess the conditions of art pedagogy and propose measures to make it more effective, relevant, and interactive. In today's session, we have with us James Elkins, Pablo Helguera, and Salima Hashmi, all three of whom have gracefully accepted the invitation to be a part of this discussion and present their views on art pedagogy. I'm sure we all will extremely benefit from their expertise and years of research, practice, teaching, and their passionate effort to reconfigure art pedagogy. Apart from their immense contributions to art history, art practice, curation, and research, what unites the three speakers tonight is that all of them are educators. There's a large audience that has come to listen to all of you. And if we were in an auditorium, it would have been completely packed and I could visualize some sitting even on the floor or standing to listen to three of you. But it's heartening to see such a wonderful gathering. And I hope that we will have a meaningful conversation tonight. The series of conversations around art pedagogy is conceptualized aiming at the diverse constellation of art institutions that exist in South Asia. Some of them have their existence dated back to colonial times, some established as part of the new momentum of the post-independent nation-building exercise, and some of them have emerged recently and have marked their existence to impact contemporary art practice and theory. Our task is not to straitjacket art practice and art institutions as new, redundant, old, traditional, etc., rather involved in finding answers for some urgent and critical questions to understand the crisis in art education of South Asia. This is a platform to ask the important and also the uncomfortable questions. And the most important one being, why is it necessary to discuss arts education at this time? Also, can art be taught? How do we account for the radical transformation that is happening in methods of research and the means of communication, especially owing to the internet and development in web technology? What are we anticipating when we are involved in these discussions? With the increased professionalization of the art practice and the bureaucratization of universities, what sort of radical pedagogy are we imagining that is free from the instrumental rationality of global capitalism? Do we need more theory or more art history? Would that solve the issue? How do we orient our students towards the process-based, research-oriented, socially engaging practice? There are many important questions, and in each session, we will attempt to answer these. Without taking more time, I would like to invite the first speaker today, Professor James Elkins. I'll introduce each speaker before their presentation so we could save time that way. Professor Elkins is Easy Shadbourne Chair in the Department of Art History, Theory, and Criticism at the Art Institute of Chicago and Head of History of Art at the University College Cork, Ireland. He got a graduate degree in painting and then switched to art history, got another graduate degree, and went on to do the PhD in art history, which he finished in 1989, all from the University of Chicago. He is the author of many of these books which you are familiar, Pictures and Tears, How to Use Your Eyes, What Painting Is, and The Strange Place of Religion in Contemporary Art, and The Master Narratives and Their Discontents, all published by Routledge. I've requested Jim to respond to three specific issues and questions. One is related to the art institution as a nurturing environment for the artist. The second about the relevance of discussing art education in these times. And finally, about the curriculum problems in terms of what to be included and what to be removed when we are engaged in this task of curriculum restructurings. Thank you, Jim. I request you please go ahead and start the presentation.
All right, thank you. Well, okay, so these are enormous questions, and I'd be very lucky if I managed to say just a few things about them in 15 or 20 minutes. But I wrote them down and I put some quick answers in. So I'll talk about them each one in turn. First, your first question was about the idea that art is kind of an agar-agar when you're in art school and you're in a scientist petri dish and you're being nourished. That is one of the theories of how art education works. And it also, by the way, although you didn't mention this, there's also the metaphor of pregnancy that an art institution nurtures the art students in it in the same way that a pregnant woman nurtures the child in her. So in terms of theories of art teaching, that's a particularly interesting one because in a sense, of course it's true. If you're a happy student, you do feel nurtured. But the difficulty, or one of the difficulties with it, is that the mother, to use the pregnancy version of this metaphor, doesn't control things on a conscious day-to-day basis. The organic, the organism is doing the controlling in a physical way. Or if you prefer the bacteria metaphor, you put the bacteria, student bacteria, I guess, in the petri dish and let them thrive as best you can. So in terms of it, as a theory of teaching, it's a bit odd because it means that teachers don't have control at the level of the classroom or day-to-day work, but they have control or understanding at a higher level when they're setting up the institution. So I thought I'd mention that, even though it wasn't actually the point of your first question. Your first question then went on to ask, how does this controlled environment or nurturing function work with online teaching? So I'd say just a couple things about that. I have been working on that more or less since COVID started, because when we first, when we were first forced to go remote at my institution, we set up a task force to see if we could figure out what things actually worked better online, because everyone was complaining about Zoom. And there are large numbers of forums in which people were saying all the horrible things about Zoom and about distance learning. So we set up a group to try to see if there was a way to think about it either neutrally or positively. So to think about online learning in a neutral way, I think it is possible to imagine Zoom as a medium, as opposed to an obstacle or a technological help, I suppose. If you think about Zoom as a medium, then like any other medium, it has its strengths and weaknesses. As artists, we're all trained to address the medium and to think about what the medium can do. If it's painting, it can do some things. If it's video, it can do other things. So with that in mind, we tried to assemble a list of things that Zoom could do as a medium that other media can't do. So there's a couple of obvious ones. For example, Zoom has a drawing function. So if someone shares their screen, everyone can draw on it. And early on in Zoom, we discovered that artists who make very small pieces of work can actually receive much better critiques on Zoom than they can in person. For example, I had a student who was making tiny glass pieces. They were about this big, but very colorful. And when I had seen them in the studio, we were, holding them like this and pointing to parts of them. We couldn't really talk about them except as a handful of them. But on Zoom, all of a sudden, there were high resolution images the size of our screens of individual sculptures that she had made. And we could put and draw little arrows and point to them much better than we could with our fingers. So that's a trivial example. A more interesting example, perhaps, is one that was proposed by one of the faculty members, who said that he teaches concepts of installation art. And he finds that it's actually useful to sometimes be separated from the environment of the artwork, because it can clear your mind and help you to think about the concepts that you're talking about. You're not, quote unquote, distracted by the object. I mean, in the end, of course, you want to be distracted by the object because you want to be in the installation. But his idea was that sometimes it really helps to be compelled to speak separately to it. I thought I would add one more thing, which I'll just put in chat for everybody. There is, since the beginning of COVID, there's been a Facebook group with that title that I just put in chat. And it's now much less active than it was. But if any of you are interested in this, I would recommend that book, that Facebook group. If you go back to the beginning of COVID, you'll find hundreds of threads of people trying to understand how to do online studio art education. like anything else online, you'll have to spend a long time at it till you find the good stuff, but there's a lot of great material in there. I will later on paste our list of things, or actually I can probably best do that right now. I can paste a short version of our list of things that we found that maybe Zoom does better than in-person education. I'll have to do that later. I'm having a little some difficulty there, so I'll do that later. Okay, so I wanted to go on to the other two questions that Premjish gave me. First one, the second one is, why is it important to discuss teaching in art education at all? And he wrote, this may seem like a basic question, but I feel it's important to discuss it because as I was arguing in my own work, even if art teaching is incoherent, it's still really important to understand it as best as possible. To this, I would like to try to answer, it's a very general question, but I would like to try to answer it. Why worry about these things at all? Why not just go to class and, you know, make the best out of your institution that you can? First point, I think, would be that it's very important to think about how you're being taught. How do your teachers think that they're teaching you? What do your teachers think that they're doing in the classroom? The commonest answer to that question is that they're inspiring you. Another maybe second most common answer would be that they're providing you with context and skills. And some art teachers are interested in providing theory and so on. There's a whole range of possible answers, but it's also quite likely that if you were to ask your teacher how they're teaching, they wouldn't really have an answer. A lot of teachers don't have an educational philosophy. These are very useful conversations to have, because if your teacher, for example, believes in the agar or pregnancy theory, then that means your teacher they're letting themselves off the hook, you might say, for things like lesson plans. They're thinking in broader terms about what they can do for you while you're in the institution. On the other hand, if your teacher feels that all they can do is teach skill, that raises interesting questions about why they think they can teach what they're doing teaching fine art, if they think they can only teach skills. So I'm just answering a general question with a very general answer. It's very useful sometimes to have these conversations. Then in a different sense, it's also important to think about how you're being taught, because evaluation in art schools is changing quickly. 15 or 20 years ago, there were relatively few quantified spreadsheets that enabled your teachers and administrators to assess your work as a student. Now, these things are very common. If you Google art rubric, you may find a number of these spreadsheets, which are tables of things that you're supposedly, that they're supposedly trying to teach you and that you're supposedly learning, with rows and columns with different evaluations of how you do on each one of these. At your institution, your teachers may very well not use these spreadsheets themselves, but administrators probably do, because administrators also have to do what they call assessment. So there is an important but confusing distinction between evaluation and assessment. Evaluation is what your teacher does when they're thinking about your classroom, what you've done in the class individually. Assessment is something that administrators do, and chairs of departments and deans and so on, when they're trying to judge how a department or a class or a teacher has been doing year by year to see if they can see a continuity and improvement. Assessment in the last decade or so has been entirely taken over by quantification and spreadsheets. So it's worthwhile looking into these things. They're not secret. You can ask people about them. You can see how they work in your institution, and who's worrying about them and who's not, because somebody in the institution is undoubtedly quite worried about them. These days, it's pretty much universal that institutions want to compare themselves with others. And so these quantified assessment spreadsheets and rubrics and so on are shared in between schools. So it's useful to think about how you're being taught in that sense too, in an institutional way. Third aspect of, I guess, a general answer to this question, why worry about this at all, is more personal, having to do with your practice. I don't think that it's ever a useless exercise to ask yourself if you need art history at all. I try to raise this in my own classes at all levels. We raise it with freshmen who are just beginning to learn the history of art and getting their World Art Survey, and we raise it all the way up to the MFA level and the PhD level with art students at those higher levels. Because it should never be a given that art history is just useful. There are a number of ways in which art history can be said to be deleterious to practice. It can hurt your practice to know too much art history. We can talk about this in the Q&A if you want. The exact same question goes with art theory. Do you need art theory for your practice? It's a question you need to keep asking yourself every time someone mentions some book that you need to read or some theorist, and every time some teacher mentions some theory source that you're supposed to know. You can ask yourself this question again about the utility of theory. Do you need any of it? For some career paths, you absolutely don't. For others, you definitely do. And it can be difficult to know at the moment in context when you should have it, when you shouldn't. Okay, I want to say also something briefly about the third question that Premjish gave me, which is a brief discussion, he says, of the curriculum problem about whether or not art students should be taught things apart from arts. So this question of liberal arts education in art academies, art schools, and art departments is an ongoing question. In the United States, where I teach, it's taken for granted that any institution large enough should give its undergraduate art students a liberal arts education. In this context, in the North American context, what that means, what liberal arts means is humanities, social sciences, a little bit of, say, sociology, a little bit of anthropology, a little bit of classics, and so on, and parts of sciences. So the option to take a physics course and so on. At the bigger institutions, these are taken for granted as good things. In my institution, we have a, quote, liberal arts department, which also does science and therefore functions as a kind of mini university. In Europe, it's not so widespread an idea that there should be the equivalent of a liberal arts education for art students at undergrad level, at the BFA level. It's not part of the culture because they come from the different educational models in use there. Although the UK model includes both of these, and so it's of course influential around the world. So this question depends on what is contained in that phrase, liberal arts education. And my institution is fairly typical of mid-size and larger art schools that try to provide this kind of education, in that we can't be a miniature university. So we have, I think, three full-time faculty who are trained in sciences, and they just teach the sciences they know. So we have, luckily, we have some really interesting people. We have a person interested in volcanoes. She teaches great classes, which inspire students on topics of ecology and global warming and things like that. But we've also had people who teach things or specialists in things that are maybe not so interesting. We had at one point a mathematician who was interested in projective geometry. Nobody knows what that is. Nobody really wanted to take those classes. They ended up in them as requirements. And it would be very hard to argue that if you graduated having taken one of that person's classes, you would have a well-rounded education. So the first question that I would ask about this in reply is exactly what is meant by education in arts, humanities, and sciences outside of the arts. There's also, and this would be the last point that I would add here, there's also this question of whether or not these fields outside the arts should be instrumentalized for artists. In other words, should the people who are teaching them teach what they think that artists, art students, would like to know or should know, or should they represent their own fields? So if we have someone, for example, we have a person who teaches history of religions. It's a very popular course, and people come at it from many different backgrounds and very interested and this person does a good job. However, this person is very interested in just one person in the history of religion, and that's the surrealist Georges Bataille. This particular faculty member, it's a friend of mine, believes that he should instrumentalize or tailor his courses so that all of his students become disciples of Bataille. Now that's fabulous for some, I see Salima smiling, that's fabulous for some students, but absolutely the wrong thing to do for other students. students, but this is a discussion that most universities and art schools, departments, and academies don't have. This question of whether or not the faculty should tailor or focus their or change their specialties so that they address what they think art students should know. That's the conundrum and the reason why it's not often discussed, because there is no theory about what art students should know. So there isn't any guide, there are no guideposts for how to change education so that it fits art students in any reliable way. Okay, so like I said, they're huge subjects, and I think I might just stop there because there's, no, I mean, a million questions could come from all this.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you for those responses. And yeah, I think the Batal problem is a universal problem, and that exists in all the art departments and the universities, where there is the kind of foregrounding and also imposition of certain practices, certain tradition, certain intellectual traditions onto the students. And that keeps on happening every year, year after year after year. So thank you for that. But again, would you like to elaborate on that particular point? Because I think this is a very crucial discussion which we should have about the relevance of art theory and art history, and how it could also be detrimental on the practice of the artists. And
yeah, sure. I can add a couple of concrete examples to that. I think one of the easiest ones, because it's easy to Google, is if you look at German expressionists. So in German and Austrian expressionists, so people like Nolde and Schiele, and I could put a couple of those in the chat. If you look at these people who were doing expressionist kind of, I'm just putting a couple in the chat. Kirchner. If you look at the people like that, they were doing very interesting work, say around 1910, 1905, 1910. These artists, for those of you who don't know them, they absolutely hated academic art. They hated the ways that art had been taught. They were tremendously rebellious and anarchic in their lifestyles as well. And then some of them lived on past the First World War, especially the third one I put on the list there, Ernst Ludwig Kirchner. And at that point, sometime around 1918, 1920, they started getting interested in the history of art and in practices that maybe they could draw on. So before, they had been like really bad art students deliberately, you know, because they were not looking up at any precedents. They were just trying to rebel. Then after the First World War, they'd started spending time in libraries, basically looking up history of art. And artists like Kirchner got substantially worse as the decades went on, because they learned more and more about art history, and they lost the freedom and the craziness that they had had. And in the case of Kirchner, ended up producing kind of Picasso pastiches, but they were also kind of hypnotized by medieval art of their own countries. So those are three pretty concrete, or two pretty concrete examples of the bad effect that art history can have. In this case, that bad effect is that it made those artists less adventuresome, and they felt more beholden to history. And I give one more quick example here. I would like to contrast here the difference between Kandinsky's book Concerning the Spiritual in Art and Frank Stella's book, which is called Working Spaces, published in 1987 or something like that. So the Kandinsky book, I'm sure some of you know, it's still often assigned. That book has no mention of any art history or art historians. Kandinsky just tells you how to look at his paintings. Yellow means this, square means that, triangle means this. The Stella book was done after consultation with art historians at Harvard and other places. And he's constantly looking over his shoulder at them in this book to check to see if his facts are right, even though his theories in that book, if you ever go to read it, if you're interested in abstract painting, it's still an interesting book. His theories are nutty. And he didn't need to ask anybody what he was doing, but art history has a kind of a hold now. So those are two concrete examples of a larger problem there about art history.
There's a question for you, and I think it also connects with your book again. Do you think the objective evaluation tools like rubrics, which is based on Bloom's taxonomy, is apt for the evaluation of courses like paintings or basic design? It's asked by Sampath RD.
Let's see. So Bloom's taxonomy, out of curiosity, can I hear what that is? Yeah, I could answer without it, but I'm actually curious to hear what that is. Maybe Sambath could put it in chat. there are certainly these sources for these rubrics. While that's going in chat, I think the way I would in general answer that is that no, they're not apt. They usually don't fit. We have an administrator here. I think I put this in a nutshell. We were in one of our many meetings talking about our own spreadsheets, and we were talking about criteria like the student should be eloquent, should be able to defend their work. The student should synthesize form and content, and students should synthesize form and color. All these kinds of things were going into our spreadsheets. And one of our administrators who hates these spreadsheets said, asked the administrators in the room, did they know about the artist Manzoni, the Italian artist who put artist shit in cans? He made tins of his own shit, supposedly. She said, where does that go on the spreadsheet? Don't we need a separate column for that, for artists who want to do that? Should we put that in there? And of course, she knew this wasn't going to happen, but the point was that spreadsheets always omit a tremendous amount, especially when you start out with the best of intentions, taking your most important criteria that you use in your teaching and try to put them in the spreadsheet. You're still always leaving things out. So the short answer there is that I have yet to see any spreadsheet that adequately or organically or sensitively captures the language that's used in studio art instruction.
Is there any question from the audience? Someone who would like to speak and ask can raise their hands. One question, we can have one question quickly. Okay, Indro.
There is a question there in chat, by the way, about art criticism.
Yeah. Okay, Indro Pramit has, Indro
Pramit
is a faculty member at the MS University, Baroda, where he teaches fine arts, and he's also a painter artist. Yes, please ask.
Yeah, I think this debate is an ongoing debate, but listening to you and looking back at our experience here in Baroda, which is an art school that happened in the post-colonial period, there were lots of experiments initially about teaching anthropology, a bit of philosophy, ancient languages and stuff like that. But eventually it had to be whittled down because if you have it in a structured course, then often, as Mr. Elkins has quite rightly pointed out, it becomes a non-starter for so many people. It may work for one or two. So I think in my considered opinion, it's best to have these options open and for self-learning, and people should have access to them. And then they should structure their learning syllabi according to their own inclinations, to have them as compulsory things in an art school, which is primarily for, I should assume, training studio artists or people related to that, which is, at the risk of being ridiculed, I would say primarily a studio practice, because that is also a sort of contested territory, increasingly. But keeping that Rubicon in head, I would say that, you know, all these things are possible, but the moment we structure them, we are basically walking down a blind alley, because then you are making it compulsory. And by making it compulsory, like Mr. Elkins' examples show, you're basically asking people to walk down the wrong road. And to illuminate the point, we are in a bit of a doldrums these days in art education, as far as art education in general, in the higher education and sector, that is in the universities are concerned, is facing a crisis. The crisis is that there has been a norm by the University Grants Commission that anybody from 20 to 21 who's going to be appointed needs to have a PhD and a research orientation to be part of that academia. The risk of that being implemented, and it will be, it looks like, by all indications, is that you will now basically leave out practitioners and create a cadre of people who are trained as art educators, and there is no training for that. So it kind of leaves you in a limbo because you are basically discouraging practicing artists from joining the institute. So overstructuring and having these fixed norms can actually backfire, in my view, majorly. Thank you.
So if I can add something to that, there's also the danger in some institutions and some places of requiring instructors to have PhDs in practice from practice-led PhD programs. So that is for those of you who for those of you art students and may not know that you can get PhD.
No, but that is that. Yeah, we are aware of that, but that unfortunately is not yet approved. So yeah, there were many attempts, and there is a great big confusion because these policies are often decided by education bureaucrats who have no idea what art education is all about, and they have a policy framework which is, you know, assuming that what is good for the goose is good for the gander, which is often not the case.
This these practice-led PhDs in some parts of the world, they're so prevalent that the administrators think that every instructor has to have a degree. This happens mostly in African countries like Uganda and Kenya, where faculty members who are already teaching are compelled to take leaves of absence and go usually to London and get these PhDs in practice-led art. Also in Malaysia and other parts of the world, Eastern Europe, in Romania, it happens. Depends on where you are, because they're very unevenly spread. I mean, in the US, we also don't have many of these. But the reason I wanted to be sure and add this here is that that's a kind of hybrid between what you're talking about and an ordinary art education. These practice-led PhDs they're held by people who have completed 200 or 300 or 400-page research dissertations. So they are a kind of a hybrid between a normal artist and an administrator, you might say, in the sense that they have research. They have a lot of understanding of how research should go, and they want to usually implement it. So that's another issue anyway, to add to the mix.
Thank you. Thank you. I think we are running out of time too. Thank you, Jim. Thanks a lot for those responses. And I think this is a longer discussion, and we need a long time to deliberate on this. And I was also thinking of various aspects which one could again talk about, like issues related to critique, issues about mentoring. There are a lot of these process-oriented curriculum like influencing structures and practices that has to be brought into these discussions. And I think in the coming days, we will do that too. Thank you for your time, and thank you for these valuable insights. Thank you for joining us today. And I invite Pablo right now. Pablo's work, if you are familiar with his practice and his writings, especially when I encountered them, was a revelation to me, because at that time I was caught up in reconfiguring a course called Art After World War II and restructuring it as Strategies of Being Contemporary in the Post-War World. And his critical and passionate interventions in social practice and endeavors to frame a pedagogy around it is amazing. And what is important in Pablo's approach is that he does not fetishize the social practice. Instead, he carefully guides us to make us understand that it is not an easy task to frame this pedagogy. There's a cautious step which he takes, but he prepares, he attempts. And it's a fabulous book. All of you should read that. I'll briefly introduce Pablo to all of you. He's a New York-based artist working with installation, sculpture, photography, drawing, socially engaged art, and performance. Helguera's work focuses on a variety of topics ranging from history, pedagogy, sociolinguistics, ethnography, memory, and the absurd in formats that are widely varied, including the lecture, museum display strategies, musical performances, and written fiction. Helguera has worked since 1991 in a variety of contemporary art museums, most recently as head of public programs at the education department of the Guggenheim Museum in New York from 1998 to 2005, From 2007 to 2020, he was director of adult and academic programs at the Museum of Modern Art, New York. He has organized close to 1,000 public events in conjunction with nearly 100 exhibitions. He is currently assistant professor of arts and entrepreneurship at the College of Performing Arts at the New School in New York. I welcome you, Pablo. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Premjish. It's great to be here and wonderful presentation, Jim. It's have many things to think of, to say about it, but right now I have prepared a presentation that is very different from what we have discussed before in terms of the relationship between art and pedagogy. This presentation, which is going to be brief, it's about how I see that relationship between socially engaged art and education, and how this relationship is related to the problem of art as representation. So I'm going to try to share my screen now. Okay, can you all see? Yeah. So I would like to start with an anecdote, and this presentation is mostly anecdotes and reflections on that relationship. Going back to around a decade ago, there was a project by a collective in New York known as the Bruce High Quality Foundation. It was a group of artists, emerging artists who were provocateurs in many ways, creating performative work that function as I think as a critique of the entire art system in some ways. They were recent graduates from an art school here from Cooper Union. And one of the projects that they presented in 2011, actually before that, but it was still running around 2011 where this image is from, was called the Bruce High Quality Foundation University. They basically decided that they will create an alternative art school. And of course, because I'm an educator, and as Premjish has mentioned, have worked in museums for many, many years, I was immediately interested in knowing what this art school was about. They leased a building in the area of Tribeca in New York, in Manhattan, and you could visit that building and take classes. The space was kind of a little, honestly, chaotic. Everything was happening. It looked like an ongoing party. It was kind of really fun and interesting and performative. However, it was not clear what exactly you were learning in this art school. And they never really had a teaching philosophy. They didn't really have a structure for what they were teaching. They were just a number of presentations by different artists. And it raised in my mind a number of questions about how artists engage with education, pedagogy, and in general with transformative action through art. At the same time, an artist who I am very close to and who is, I think, an extraordinary artist, Tania Bruguera, was creating another project that still continues to this day. It is called Immigrant Movement International. Tania Bruguera is a Cuban artist who is a dissident of the Cuban government. She currently lives in Cuba and is determined to stay there to protest the Cuban regime and its censorship practices. She created this project to defend immigrant rights in the United States, initially with the idea of creating a party for immigrants. And then it later became an organization that is essentially an education and advocacy organization for immigrants that was unusual in the sense that it was a partnership with the Queens Museum that funded this nonprofit organization. And it gave them money to jumpstart it with Creative Time, which is another art agency in New York City. And Immigrant Movement continues as an organization today. It's a nonprofit and continues its work as in the advocacy world, which is really important. And it is located in the borough of Queens in New York City, which is one of the most diverse, if not the most diverse borough in the country. So The question really is, like, what is really the relationship between these two types of projects that are essentially kind of about education and about how making a social change? To me, these all relate to something that I tend to call pretend play. And the ability of art of engaging with a new reality and representing that reality versus and creating, making perhaps a critique of that reality versus the possibility of art really embodying that reality and having an impact in that reality. In my perspective, the work that is most significant and impactful done by an artist, and this is why I gravitated towards socially engaged art, is the work that artists like Tanya do, who do not see a difference between creating art as a representation and art being the embodiment of a particular action. So you do not make a painting about social change. You try to enact social change through political action. And that is the work, not a depiction of what you want the world to be like. You actually create models of what that work you want it to be like. So the question really then is, how is that distinction between creative play as a performative representational act and an embodiment? What is that relationship like? And what is the role of education in giving us a consciousness of that embodiment? So for that, I just want to do a very quick review of some history of art education and the way in which it has impacted our way of thinking about a number of topics, such as social relationships, collaboration, communication, and so forth. We come from 20th century modernism, and in many ways, modernism is originated by a school, which is the Bauhaus, which was really the workshop for modern art and the place where instructors and students coexisted and collaborated in producing work that was intricately connected to design and to the modern, to the 20th century technology. As Jim knows very well, the Bauhaus is one of the schools that included Kandinsky and Klee, another major, say, called masters, who created the what we refer to as the first year program, the program that is designed to teach students the basics of design, of drawing, of sculpture, and so forth. This tradition of learning comes later. Here's Joseph Albers teaching at the Bauhaus, of course. This tradition comes to Black Mountain College in the 1940s and 50s, where many of the instructors of the Bauhaus come to teach those essential ideas of this utopian vision of design and modernism. And in the United States, professors like Albers himself are present in Black Mountain, and we know the impact that this school, this utopian alternative school, has in American art specifically and in art in general, and a very important generation of artists: Burt Cunningham, Robert Rauschenberg, and John Cage, as well as many others, have collaborations and go on to become professors themselves in other places, spreading, let's say, the gospel of modernism into the rest of the world. In my school, where I work now, the new school, John Cage was briefly a professor, and his classes became legendary. He is credited for influencing an entire generation of artists who came of age in the early 60s and then 70s, which is known as Fluxus. So this type of pedagogy that is experimental, that is intricately related to creating a whole culture of communication has a deep impact in art making. Now, the way that I can't tell you the whole history of the 20th century of pedagogy, but I think it's interesting to see how this evolution takes place and how it starts merging with social practice. The work of Joseph Beuys is deeply influential in the 1960s and 70s in his social sculptures and his way of thinking of education as a medium. That's the 1960s is the moment where this whole idea that education is not just a method to teach principles, but also a practice that can be performative and can be embodied by the artist becomes very relevant. This connects to the rise of institutional critique and the work by artists who start appropriating forms of education to create a criticism of dominant values in art and elsewhere. This is a piece by Robert Morris of the 1960s, where he hired an actor to lip sync a lecture by the art historian Panofsky. So it's a performance that is basically a simulation of a lecture. And the institutional critique also is originated by artists like Marcel Brotars, who is a Belgian conceptual artist who creates a whole museum of his own. He calls it Museum of Art, Department of Eagles. He becomes the director, the self-appointed director of this museum, and he used lectures on the. Here he's lecturing here in 1968. I think this is in Documenta, in one of the galleries of his museum. So this is kind of like a direct line of artistic strategies that goes right into Andrea Fraser, who is the American artist who creates this fictional museum docent, Jane Castleton, who in the late 80s offers these fake tours. It's a series of videos and performances that Fraser gives, ostensibly giving a gallery exhibition tour, but in a very insidious way, inserting all sorts of criticisms around the institution in her process. So that's a form of institutional critique. Then in the 90s, what we start seeing is another form of interaction and sociability that is not institutional critique related, but that it was turned by the historian and the theorist Nicolas Bourriaud, Relational Aesthetics, and best exemplified by Richard Tirvania's Meals, and the whole generation of artists from the 90s who create interactive and social experiences with individuals that are participatory. In the case of Recruit, it's having a meal, and art becomes then not just a not a criticism of an art system, but rather the creation of this format of participation for the public. So what we encounter is that we receive the legacy of these two types of practices in the terms of participatory models, like relational aesthetics gives us the social and experiential model. Institutional critique gives us these strategies of appropriation and simulation. In the case of Brotars, so like the appropriation of the language of the museum. You know, what I believe people's perceptions on this history tend to forget is that there's another kind of artistic practice that is very linked to education, and that I think it's really the one that originates socially engaged art that is worth thinking about. In this case, one example of these types of practices include Tim Rollins and KOS. Tim Rollins is an artist who was an artist who in the 1980s started advising a group of students in the Bronx and created a collective that through workshops, discussions, and mentorship, started producing works inspired in works of literature. So in many ways, to me, it's an example of a true collaboration and work with a community of artists that constitutes a really valuable form of social practice. Suzanne Lacy is another example of an artist who, since the 70s, has been involved doing collaborative and dialogue-based work. This includes these types of conferences that she organizes, often with groups of people that are at odds with one another, bring them together in the conference format. There's this example of the series of Oakland projects where she organized, among many other things, a series of encounters in the parking lots between the police and the teenagers from a particular neighborhood to talk about police violence and policing in their communities. In the early 2000s, which is when we supposedly create the term social practice, or where it emerges as a dominant term, and this I think I relate this more to my generation, a number of artists start producing projects that function as alternative schools in some fashion. Fritz Hegg, who is an artist from California, produced this project called Sundown Salon. It's essentially a geodesic dome that he designed that in his neighborhood in Los Angeles, where he will bring people together to join in conversations, discussions, and partake in performances. And other interesting models include Beta Local in San Juan in Puerto Rico. It's a collective in the old historic neighborhood of San Juan that are inspired in the work of Ivan Illich and other educators. And they produced a series of very experiential workshops that are really inspired on pragmatism, the idea of learning by doing. And their entire constitution is fluid. Like the leaders of the organization phase out, and new leaders come in, and they see themselves as a collective / alternative school that is very, very localized. So I'm sorry for this very long presentation. I just wanted to give you this general sense of the various projects that exist out there that that take what I see as education at a different level and integrate it with social action, and that embodiment of the of learning becomes very significant. And I believe that anybody who wants to learn social practice or is interested in the subject of social practice needs to take a look at how many of these projects look at art not as, again, as representing a problem, but becoming actively engaged in solving the problem, and the education process becomes really critical as part of that.
Thank you, Pablo. And thank you for that historical overview, and also many of the works which you have shown. And it reminded me of the very important debate between Maria Lind and Claire Bishop about how to assess the social practice. And you have kind of provided us a framework, a pedagogy to teach social practice. Now, I have a very basic general question is, now, how do we assess the social practice? Is ethics a parameter to assess it? Is aesthetics a parameter to assess it? What should be the parameters to assess the social practice? Because we are putting it into an institution. Mm-hmm. And the institution needs quantified results.
Mm-hmm. I believe, I speak a little bit about this topic on my book about education for socially engaged art, in very short summary, my perspective on the matter is that this type of work needs to be looked at as two different things, and perhaps it has to have examination or in two different channels. First, you can discuss it as art. you know, you can like understand it as an artwork and then use perhaps the tools of our criticism to understand this type of work. But also, I think it's incumbent upon us to really look at it as the thing that it claims is doing. So for example, if the artist is saying that they're creating a school, then I think it's valid to really assess it in the strict educational terms of the discipline. You know, so if you're really teaching, what are you teaching? How are you teaching it? What is the criteria that you're using it by teaching it, and so forth? So this is, to me, the difference between kind of simulation and actuality. You know, if you really actually are teaching, then you really then we need to like be very rigorous in how we analyze that work. So and I think it's possible to look at a project and say, well, this is a fantastic work, but it's a terrible education project, you know? Or this might be really beautiful education and very successful educationally, but as an artwork, it doesn't really function. And I think those two things can be true. And I think they're true all the time, you know? If a project is essentially like a performance, you know, like then it doesn't make any sense to analyze it as education. But I think those are the tools that we can use to take a look at a project. And I think it's also, I also in the book, I also talk about the claims that the project does. You know, what is it the claiming that it's accomplishing, you know, and how you can verify those claims, which presents a problem for traditional art criticism, because as you know, traditional art criticism is predicated generally by looking into an exhibition or like you have to really do criticism in a more imaginative, perhaps more investigative way than simply showing up at a gallery and trying to write about it, or seeing pictures that an artist gives you and the artist telling you what is happening in those pictures. Then it's difficult not to evaluate if an experiential project if you're not experiencing it yourself, you know. And I think those are some of the things that are challenges as you try to evaluate and assess a project of this nature.
Can I add something to that?
Yeah.
I wonder if there's a place there for inspiration. So I'm thinking of the Bruce High Quality Foundation. So they were very inspiring. Their existence, their sort of theoretical existence, was very inspiring to a number of artists at that time, even though people didn't usually know or couldn't give an account of what in the world they were doing there. So that it seemed, I wonder if that doesn't connect up with what we were talking about at the very beginning about art teaching in general as inspiration. There might be some allowance for maybe incoherent and ineffectual programs or ideas if they actually have that capacity to get other projects going.
That's an interesting thought. And I mean, I think that I always saw the Bruces, like this group of artists who emerged in that moment as, like, as I said before, like as provocateurs, as like these, in a way, these rowdy kind of wild group that, yes, they stirred the pot for sure. And I think that their ability to generate, to bring attention and to generate an excitement around them was interesting. And I'm sure it was inspiring for many artists, you know. Perhaps, you know, I confess, I might have looked at them very critically because I am an educator. And then, of course, when somebody comes and says, well, we're here doing a school, then I was immediately, well, what exactly are you teaching? And then I walk in and it's just like a big party where everybody's getting drunk. So, I mean, it's really not, yet again, you know, you go to the Bauhaus and probably everybody was doing the same thing, you know. But I just didn't see like a Bauhaus style pedagogy.
Is there any other question? Did anybody want to ask? Please raise your hand. We can have one question, quick question. I just wanted to again bring attention to the term social in the socially engaged art. And I think it is the least discussed and taken for granted term in the entire practice, as even terms like public in the public art, a community in community practices. These are not interrogated when they are used or applied. It is as if the public is a given, social is a given, community is a given, society is a given, and you just go into this spaces. And social practice also has this moral righteousness on it, that we are going to bring change, so we are going to these places, so we will, and the gallery, the commercial circuit is our, what you call, the other. So we go and use art to bring change. How could we, again, use education or pedagogy to reconfigure ideas of society or ideas or the concept of society or the concept of social, the concept of public, the concept of public, community? How could we reconfigure?
Well, this is a very big question. I'm not sure how to answer it. I want to say, socially engaged art is a term that in many ways has been around for a long time. You know, we have called it many other things in the past, like community art, public art, political art, and so forth. In recent years, as we are speaking about pedagogy, it's really funny to see, to me, that actually has become really academic as a term. Like now we are trying to find formulas how to teach it, you know, which perhaps might spell the doom itself of social practice, which was a practice like most practices that emerge in contemporary art that are really strong and dynamic, and then they die in academic variations. What's important to keep in mind is that socially engaged art is what I would term, again, in pedagogical terms, like a methodology or like an approach, you know, in the same way that you have the Reggio Emilia approach, or you have like a critical pedagogy. That these are a set of ideas and principles that inform the way that artists operate, you know. And as methodologies, as ideas, they are meant to be transformed. They are meant to change with times. So what we'll have 20 years from now will probably be something completely different, you know. The ideal, at least the utopian vision of, I think, in my view, the socially engaged art movement, was that it needed to create experiences and actions that could not be commodified by the art market or by the museum world. You can certainly, like with performance art, you can collect photographs and videos and even performances, you know. But socially engaged art is something else. It's like an education methodology. You know, it's an approach of dealing with the world. So I think that's at least in defense of perhaps the impossible utopian visions of socially engaged art, you know, that I would say. The other thing that I would add is that when you look at a work of an artist like Tani Bruguera or others that are that is socially engaged, a very common criticism is like, well, you didn't solve the problem, you didn't really feed the whole world, you didn't create social justice worldwide, therefore this is not good art, you know, or this is not an effective work, yeah. Which is, it's an unfair expectation of one artist creating one model of making. You know, and like we don't place the same expectations from an artist who just hangs paintings in a gallery, you know. So it's I think it's important to consider all the expectations, misplaced expectations and hopes that come together with the practice, and the opportunities that it offers as a mode of working, as a mode of thinking.
Thank you, Pablo. We have to quickly move to Professor Hashmi now.
Yes.
So we have Salima Hashmi, and Many of you must be familiar with her practice as a curator, as an artist, also as a writer, and very important for the South Asian contemporary and also South Asian contemporary art education too, with almost 50 years of teaching experience. And today we are going to utilize that experience, not of the artist, curator, and art historian, but introduce Professor Hashmi. She was the founding dean of the Mariam Dawood School of Visual Art and Design at Beaconhouse National University, Lahore. And she was professor of fine art at National College of Arts, Lahore, and was also the principal of the college. She was awarded the title of Professor Emeritus from BOG Beaconhouse National University on the occasion of the 12th convocation in 2017. And she is a council member of the Human Rights Commission of Pakistan. I welcome you, Professor Hashmi. Please go ahead with your presentation.
Thank you. Let me just start with that. I'm going to sort of whiz you through an overview of a few art and design schools in Pakistan, just like the kind of case studies, because we're looking at firstly a school which, you know, starts out as a colonial project, and we had four of them in the subcontinent, as you probably know, in Lahore and Madras and Bombay and Kolkata. And so, you know, so here we have the first principal, founding principal, who is John Lockwood Kipling. And there is the mascot that they decide is, describes the institution very well. It was the Mayo School of Arts. This is, you know, 10 years after John Lockwood Kipling. Kipling himself was very much of the sort of, you know, the William Morris School of Arts and Crafts in South Kensington, which is where he came from when he came to the subcontinent. But by this time, when the Mayo School of Arts is established, we're talking like 1930s, it had become quite staid. Yes, we had, you know, the way of working, as you can see, and I'm sure people have seen these photographs of the Mayo School of Arts and various history books. So it was very much learning, doing from the craftsmen. It was for the perpetuation of traditional crafts, but it was also introducing them to things like watercolor painting, lithography, and so on and so forth. But, you know, how long could it serve with this? Came the great change of this very staid, rather sleepy place. Satish Gujral has described it in his memoirs as a place where the ustads used to sleep on the desks and the students used to come around and serve them with hookahs. Mind you, there's a great deal of wonderful craftsmanship going on in the metalwork or in the, you know, the woodwork shop. But the kind of the verve with which John Lockwood started was a thing of the past. And then 1958, and this gentleman, Professor Sponenberg, arrives from the US of A. He's a sculptor. He's very much the Bauhaus vision. And he's been in the school at Alexandria, which he has also intervened in and changed. And there I was, a very young student. I'm kind of standing gingerly to his one side, no guesses which one I am. But what he did was really to try and lift the school out of the Mayo School tradition and bring it into a modern art and design school. And this is what happened. So it became the National College of Arts, and it had the four departments, fine art, design, architecture, and academics, which was to provide the theoretical infrastructure, if you like, which had the history of art, and it had ergonomics, et cetera, et cetera. And most importantly for him and his vision and the team that was set in place was to introduce the interdisciplinary aspect of the arts, which you know, we've talked about earlier, the foundation year, which was really the foundation in which all of these departments settled. So in the first year, you did have all of that, you know, the sort of light makes the object visible, and you had printmaking, you had the way of teaching. But I have to say that it was for Pakistan, this was a big departure from what had been the history of art education, the rather sedate South Kensington model of looking at the world and describing it. So suddenly at this place called NCA, which is still is called NCA, by the way, it was upgraded to a university just as last week. There was the, most of the learning actually, I think the important learning actually happened outside the classroom. The studios were interesting enough, but the opportunity to put all of that into practice with doing mime, with doing puppetry, none of which was in the actual curriculum, but which was generated by certain faculty members as well as the energy of the students, and became actually the spaces in which they interacted with the buildings, worked on them for at various occasions, projects which happened in those spaces and were debated and discussed, because here it was that you had the architecture students coming and to go up at what the fine art students were doing or what the design students were doing. And at a time when Pakistan was going, very often going through very, very difficult political turmoil, you would find that within, from within this institution would come the questioning which used to spill out onto the street, sometimes in the form of the women's movement, of women artists who happened to be art educators also, and I was one of them, in which we then took apart the curriculum and decided it was not serving our purpose, and then going into women's movement, how it could connect with women poets, women activists, women's lawyers, and altering the curriculum to suit. It was, these are just images that put together from various, you know, whether it was the spaces that are within the institution, and looking at ways of discussion, ways of evaluation, of opening up the evaluation moments, whether, I mean, this just happens to be an MA class with their juries. And so you had, and we always opened it up to all students who wanted to attend, which was quite a departure from the norm at art and design schools in Pakistan, where it was, you know, a very non-transparent way of really talking about. But the fact that this school changed the way of evaluation was an important step. But then eventually, as with all art and design schools, and where is it who said, you know, they should all close down after 10 years when they've done their best. It was time then for a new model. And that's how the Beaconhouse University, which was actually a liberal arts university, came about. But one of the first schools that they decided on was the School of Visual Arts and Design. So you had, and it was based on the feeling that the models, existing models, had become tired and they had become, well, far too conservative. And therefore, the Beaconhouse National University came about and were looking at ways of addressing texts or addressing phenomena, still using the foundation course in the way that, you know, we are familiar with in art schools everywhere, but looking at certain things which would cut across all of the disciplines in a more effective way. So, you know, when we had a text like this, okay, you know, light, ever since we crawled out of that primordial slime, there's been a unifying cry, more light, sunlight, torchlight, candlelight, neon incandescent lights that banish the darkness from our caves to illuminate our roads, the insides of our refrigerators, big floods for the night games at Soldiers Field, and tiny flashlights for those books we read under the covers. When we are supposed to be asleep, light is more than watts and foot candles. Light is metaphor, light is knowledge. Light is life, light is light. So you begin with this, and then in the drawing class or the design class, going in ways of This is again foundation, looking at ways of using materials and using, and these were spaces we had not yet moved into the new campus. So these were very cramped spaces. You know, there's a balcony that you're working on and got the students in there and they're working with it. And we're looking at what light can do in the space, the very, very restricted space that you have. Or, you know, in the design school that you're looking at things that students use and it's very much hands-on. So there she is wearing what she's worked on. Dekh zarur magar pyar se, for those who are Hindi speakers. And it worked towards creating an energy, which was something that led us to decide that, okay, so we are going to start a master's course in art education with the idea of offering in-service teachers or artists who want to be educators. It is a low residency program run in the summer only, allowing for teaching practice during the rest of the semesters. And therefore it was the first art education course for at university level offered in an art department in Pakistan. And it just so happened that it drew people who had education, art education as their major interest, but also succeeded in bringing back into the classroom art educators who were artists and who felt that their teaching could do with some inspiration. And then innovating in a way that, okay, if you've got a project and you want to try out a lesson plan, what if you don't do it in the classroom or a school at all? What if you try it on kids who don't go to school? What if you go into a car park and see if that lesson works? So really figuring out the possible applications for what they were doing in their courses, and then using things like musicians to come in and work on things like them. This is a very conventional, you know, the textile thesis exhibition that I threw it in for good measure. And using the architect, because by this time there was the new building. So looking at using those spaces for teaching and for things that were more informal, which allowed for the community, I say that, the student community, yes, but we, because this university is plonk in the middle of what was a rural area, a farming area outside Lahore, and which is what is happening to all our cities, is encroaching on the countryside, asking people from the village to come in if they wanted to come in, and working with them on projects, also inviting them to join into to things that the students had arranged. So the same space is, you know, used for display of soft sculpture or for teaching. And it becomes, it breaks down the separations that architecture produces in the teaching studio. And that is just that this is a 150-year-old colonial school, which becomes Bauhaus type, which generates a lot of political activism, especially among for the women's movement and the human rights movement. And then a school which starts in Karachi by professionals who decide that at that time Karachi, the largest city in Pakistan, did not have a school of art and architecture. They moved a traditional building from the center of town, brick by brick, and rebuilt it on the outskirts of the city. A lot of criticism there because some people felt that money should be used, you know, in a better way. That this is kind of an indulgence to a sort of a pastiche of a historical building in what was a new building area. But there was another opposing point of view that Karachi is a city without so much character in the new areas, and maybe this would be the beginning of something. So this is just one of the projects the students did for the 14th of August, which is Independence Day, in which they make, you know, this is a purely student-led activity. But what else? Karachi is in the province of Sindh, which has a huge tradition of craft, and then working with, inviting in and working with local craft, in which the students, and this is something I have to say was inspired with, you know, influenced by NID in India, talking to people like Ashok Chatterjee, and learning from our neighbors. I have to say that for myself, with a lot of questioning that was going on in my mind in the early 89, 80, what should be the new curriculum? I, when managed, maneuvered to go and talk to K.G. Subramaniam in Kalabhavan, where he retired to, and talk to him about the early curriculum in Baroda and bringing craft into the classroom. And, you know, he laughed at me. He said, why do you want a syllabus or a curriculum, Salima? You just need 5 good teachers. So, you know, that put me in my place. Next. So then you have, you know, you have the craft then, which becomes, crosses over between textile and sculpture and apparel, and works towards, you know, new forms, while all the time aware that the craftsperson comes from the underprivileged section of society. And when you ask the students to go and learn, they don't go there as onlookers, they go and live with the craftsperson in whichever village it is that they're looking to learn from, and translating it into then their own work, whether it is high fashion, if they are textile designers, whether it is, you know, product of a particular form like the charpai, which is anyway becoming, changing its form, from weaving to printing, and figuring out the various traditional dyes, or the ornamentation, and, you know, whether it's, again, whether it's high fashion. So Sharmi Chinoy, when she's accepting the Oscar for her documentary, she's wearing something done at the school. So there's this constant back and forth and a learning, which was something new at the time, but because the school has evolved very strongly as a design school, they're looking for inspiration within the city and popular culture, on the, you know, on the roads, at the, on the footpath, and drawing from it into their own imagery. And lastly, I just quickly show that, okay, we talked about the artist's practice, the artist who's an educator, who is also in their practice working with urban artisans in a collaboration, which is a real collaboration, where it is not skimming off the labor or the expertise or the tradition that the artisan is heir to, but innovating and finding new forms in which the artisan is a full-fledged collaborator. So Adila Suleiman, who is a sculptor and was also heading the art department at the school, is one of the people who has really brought in the artisans, developed a studio which is large enough to accommodate them, and the many elements that they bring into her practice, in which very often they have a great toing and froing about what they think ought to be going in her work. And this is a particular thing that she had done, which was these figures of females, which are done in the way that the artisans actually used to use for making the trucks and ornamentation on trucks. So there she is with her team, and she is the only woman there. There's quite a lot of, very often, this whole joking about the place of the woman in this setup. So I'll end with that image. And you know, this is just meant for you to a very quick overview of what has been happening in traditional schools and new schools. And as I said, these are just three case studies, but I hope gives you a taste of what we've been at.
Thank you, Salima ji. Thank you for that wonderful presentation and also giving us an overview about what is happening in the Pakistan region and also in the various colleges and departments there. I could see that there's a lot of interest, a return to the so-called traditional practices or what we have created, this binary craft practices. Is there a methodology which is given to the students, or is there kind of an instruction or guidance you give to the students when you ask them to go out and explore these practices?
I think that's a very critical point, because and different institutions have evolved different ways and different methodologies of actually approaching historical tradition, which is constantly changing. And for example, Shanaz Ismail, who is a professor emeritus in Indus Valley, and I both went to Bahawalpur to the university there because we were on the jury for the thesis, and we especially asked to go out of Bahawalpur to go to a village which is known for its dye and dye techniques and so on. And we were absolutely delighted, firstly, to find that what was a very, very, I mean, a traditional way of working is entirely taken over, firstly, by the women, and not just in terms of the labor, but in the management of what they were doing. So they had this the village in which the men were sitting is mostly on their haunches, which is true about most villages as one sees them in Pakistan, at least, except in the sowing season and in the harvesting season. And you had them on their cell phones and taking orders, making work, making fresh kind of work. And Shanaz said to me, you know, that is the kind of crafts person who our students should actually be working with. In the Indus Valley School, they insist that the students take their interaction with any craftsperson in a manner in which they are very, very aware of A, the economic class, the difference, the way that the student is embracing and approaching the great economic disparities, the great social disparities, and are trying to see where this person fits in the local community and why that particular craft is slowly fading. What is their role? What are they for? Are they predators? Are they supplicants? They have to work out these ends, and the school gives them after discussion, gives them a set of questions. And then it's up to each student to figure out, you know, how they look at what it is. We have to be honest that this is a very unequal situation in which people who are repositories of hundreds of years of tradition are not given either the status or the economic advantage, which is their right. What do they have that is wanted, if you like? I think this is a very open question, and craft department, textile department, which is mainly working on this, evolves its own strategies, and they're very, very different. So I don't want to be dismissive of any one of these ways of making it an educational experience, because I have seen unusual results where one thought that, you know, this is just not going to work, but it has. And then there are others which, I mean, I'll give you an example of, we had a student from Bangladesh who wanted to work on carpets and daris. And I sort of said, pointed him towards a group that was working in part of Lahore. It ended in an extraordinary back and forth between the student and that group, with him transferring so much of his expertise in dyes to them, which they had lost. And they, in fact, then making him the recipient of their weaving skills. So it became a very interesting give and take. And so there's so many things, I think, that happen, which you are not not certain of. But if you have, if the teacher has done their job in preparing the student with just a set of questions and no answers, I think it's much more enriching experience, both for the student, for the artisan who is suddenly coming to terms with the thought that they are not necessarily lost, forgotten, but they have a possibility of innovating and enhancing their skills. And as a result, actually, of that interaction, that community moved to a larger space, and they are now working with other designers and who are, you know, it's becoming a different, a totally different product, but it has, it's traveled a long way. I think these are very tricky terrain. And I have learned so much from people like Ashok Chatterjee about how the art school actually has to contend with massive issues which are not of their making or over which they actually have very little control, but doing certain things which can be of value and can be learned from. And each time, you know, there's a different kind of learning that's happening.
Thank you. Thank you, Salima ji. All these institutions, like you mentioned, also have very inspiring history of resistance, you know, very politically active institutions. And therefore, there is a presence of, again, a socially engaging practice. How do you frame it as a curriculum? And was there any resistance when you attempted to institutionalize?
Well, you're asking somebody who's always been in the eye of the storm.
That's right.
Yes, I have been hauled up in front of the Board of Governors for spreading obscenity, for instigating students to riot, etc., etc. All of which was in certain ways true. But the thing is that you manage strategies, develop strategies, think on your feet. There was a time in Zia's period when I was teaching a class of life drawing, though you don't have nudes, but I mean, and this huge band of vigilantes rushed in and they came and they said, you know, what are you doing? So I said, I'm teaching, you know, life drawing. But why have you not Islamized your teaching? So I said, yes, you know, I'm very keen to do that. And in fact, I've written off to the medical school, which is just across the way, asking how they're Islamizing the teaching of anatomy, because that's what I'm doing over here. And I'm waiting for their response. So the guy was very, you know, terribly courteous in who's heading them. He said, really, have you said? I said, yes, you know, we're just waiting for their answer. As soon as they tell us how they are going to Islamize the teaching of anatomy, I'm just going to follow suit and I'm going to do it right here in this art school. Well, he didn't come back after that. But the thing is that you, if the class is enjoyable enough, and if the students can see the relevance possible relevance to their lives. And in you know, under military dictatorship, it's different. And in oppressive democratic times, it's different. You learn to sort of shift the goalposts as you go along. How you do it in the curriculum, I think you leave the curriculum open-ended in certain ways and fairly structured in other ways. And that is more or less that one, what was that? You know, you have a certain thing that, okay, they have to produce a body of work, which you don't, you know, you don't sort of lay down exactly what a form it has to be. But there has to be a body of work to show some sustained thinking and, you know, asking and solving. And it works so far, but there have been people who've who had greater problems than I have had. Many times when teachers have decided it's not worth the trouble and gone back to being artists and no longer want to be teachers. And teachers, of course, who come to grief too when the system is stronger than they are. But you're making art, whatever it is that you're doing.
Thank you, Salima ji. Is there any other questions from the audience? Yeah, Indro, please, yeah, ask.
Hello, what a pleasure to be in this discussion. And like you have picked the brains of Manisab, I've often looked up at your example. This is an observation, this is not a question, but listening to your experience, knowing a little bit about, you know, the how revolutionized you, you did the teaching of the National College, and also our experience this side of the border. I do see a commonality in the fact that, of course, like Manisab used to say that this is these are the places of living tradition, and South Asia is. But simply, when you say socially engaged art in a Western context, it often leads to the art of not making. So the artifact becomes an absolutely either a perfunctory thing or out of the picture. Whereas here, it seems socially engaged art is primarily also engaged with the art of making, so as opposed to art of not making. And like Mr. Helguera was mentioning, this student the teacher, I think, that it's not about making a painting about, you know, bringing social change, it is more about what you do out there. You know, that's a form of doing, but it's not necessarily making something. Whereas in this South Asian context, socially engaged art often means making something. I would just like to hear your comments on that.
I think if there are groups of people who you have the privilege to be in a position to mentor, or you're their teacher, whatever, I think that there are two levels of providing them with tools, if you like. There is, you know, the things that go into inverted commas making, and then there are the things that go into thinking. And I think that both are equally important. I think one, as a teacher, the first thing you don't do is to have preconceived notions about what the outcome of a particular project or a particular set of things that you're working with will be. I was taught by a five-year-old who I was teaching in a school in England in my youth. And this five-year-old, it was actually just the night after the first men had landed on the moon, and kids had been watching all night, and they came to school in the morning and they were so excited. And this young boy, 5-year-old, he said, I want to do a big painting about space. And I was thrilled and I thought, okay, he's going to do this marvelous painting, which is going to be put up in the hall. And the headmistress is going to say to me, you know, what a fantastic teacher you are. Well, I gave him a big piece of paper and he disappeared into the corridor. And 1 hour later, I go back and he has painted my whole big sheet of paper totally black from one end to the other. And my face falls, but I stop myself and I say, oh, how lovely, Thomas. What is your painting about? And he looks at me and he says, space. So I was taught by a 5-year-old that the most important thing we learned that night as we watched television and we watched, you know, the first man step onto the moon was about the blackness of space. And I thought, you know, he'll be making these spaceships and he'll be making an image of the moon and blah, 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 blah. And so I learned right there as to what my philosophy, my educational philosophy was going to be. Not to either preempt or to underestimate the worth of the critical thinking of the younger people who one is in contact with, but to be constantly on the watch out for seeing how these things can go into the next level. So the making of an object may be the outcome, yes, and because there's such a strong tradition in South Asia of the making of things. And so they carry that burden of those hundreds of years on their shoulders as they go into the studio. But they also have, I think, the wherewithal to move that burden if need be. And that is, I think, the most important thing that as a teacher, you learn as to when the student is able to shift the burden and when it is that you need to step back and say, okay, it's your world. You're making it now. So my 5-year-old taught me everything that the teacher needs to know, really.
Thank you. Thank you. Pablo, would you like to comment on this, dematerialization, binary?
Yeah, I mean, I just wanted to perhaps characterize a little bit what I meant by this idea of rebelling against the object and making. I mean, I am myself a maker. I make a lot of objects all the time. And to me, in fact, it's a very important practice. I make drawings, I make collages, you know. So I don't think that the act itself of making is objects is against socially engaged art. You know, I think you can have a socially engaged practice and be an object maker. I think the position with, I think at least many artists of my generation relates more to the art market and the fact that the art market is so object dominated and it makes art into a commodity. It makes it into something that is sold and exhibited and auctioned and things like that. And that to us is something that is very external to really the community aspect of art making, the way in which we connect with others, the way that we establish human dialogue connections and dialogues, you know. So it's more a position against the idea that whatever you make becomes a product that becomes consumed and exhibited and purchased and repurchased and so forth, you know. But some of the examples that I showed, there's really, for example, I was thinking of this group that I reference in San Juan, Puerto Rico. They have a very beautiful practice that they invite people to learn weaving, like a particular kind of basket weaving in their town, while somebody is reading a text, you know, and they discuss essays and different kinds of like articles or books that they want to have a conversation about. So they use this kind of a very traditional Caribbean tradition that goes back to like the cigar factories, you know, where people were rolling cigars while somebody was reading at the front of the room, you know, and reading like a novel or something like that. and use the practice itself of making as a social communication practice. So that's an example of where like something making something and being community are completely connected. So in that sense, I think it can be a really beautiful and powerful practice.
Okay.
Thank you for this wonderful, profound discussion, all of you. And thank you for joining today. And we'll announce the next sessions. This is an ongoing conversation, and I will inform you about the next session. But thank you, Pablo, and thank you, Salima ji, for joining us today. Thank you for your overview. Thank you for your insights, and thank you for this very intense discussion.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Good night, everyone. Thank you for being.